Springsteen gets round to recording a new album with his new band. And yes, it does include songs about cars. Also this week, a new publishing venture, a magazine that comes complete with an 11-track album. And a video from the man Billy Bragg called a hamster on this programme last week, the massively popular Howard Jones. And to discuss all that, here's Robin Campbell of UB40, who are currently working on a new album, though Labour of Love is still in the charts after 38 weeks. John Taylor of Duran Duran, who of course were number one all last month with The Reflex. He's now working with members of Cheek in a studio band, Cheek. Big Brother, and working on Duran's forthcoming live album and film. And Mark Ellen, here in his role as editor of Smash Hits, by far Britain's best-selling music paper. And we'll start with the hamster, Howard Jones, one of the major British successes of the past year, maybe because all the girls want to pet him. He started off as a one-man synthesizer band, playing in clubs near his hometown, High Wycombe, and later added a mime artist, Jed Hoyle, to prance around the stage next to him. His debut album, Humans Lib, went straight to number one, and four singles taken from it have now reached the top 10. This month, he releases an hour-long video, Like to Get to Know You Well. It starts with Howard signing autographs and being driven around in a Mercedes before giving a concert in his home territory at High Wycombe Town Hall. Videos for some of his singles are cut in. From the set, here's a song with a typical Howard Jones message, Conditioning. Oh, welcome to John, Howard's arguably, I suppose, the most successful British artist since Duran Duran.
Arguably, I say.
What's his appeal?
I don't know. There's something I can't bring myself to dislike the guy. There's something very amiable about him.
Do you actually like him, though?
Well, maybe that's his worst point, I think. There's something very okay. He's just very...
Like pettable.
Very pettable, yeah. Very pettable. I mean, not that I'd pet him myself. Watching the video all the way through, there's a whole hour of that. And I was a little bit disappointed because I think that the record company obviously thought, well, we've got to get a video out on the shelves because everybody has a video out these days. And, after one album and OK Four hit singles, I don't think you've got enough to provide an hour's worth of visual entertainment. I mean, the Beatles took 10 years to get the complete Beatles together. I mean, we put 10 tracks out after 4 years. And I don't think it doesn't yet do enough. I mean, I quite like his music, but visually, for an hour on a TV screen, I didn't find it enough.
It's not enough. I mean, just a few of the videos cut in.
And yeah, I mean, that was the best. That was the best points, I thought. And also the live footage from High Wycombe. I think the idea of going back to your hometown and doing it in High Wycombe Town Hall, it's all very nice, but it didn't make for a very impressive visual. And he's actually singing flat all the way through the show as well, which is a bit of a shame.
especially but you like
he's
him,
watching
though.
It. But, I mean, having said that, I quite like the chap.
Mark, at work as an editor of a Smash Hits with a very young readership, you must get a lot of interest in Mr. Jones. I mean, is he your most popular artist
he's not
you write
popular.
About?
Not my most popular, by a long way. That's what it says on the film, doesn't it?
I mean, that
is cuddly. He thinks he's
cuddly. What do you think his appeal is there?
I don't know.
I've never quite seen it.
His appeal is certainly something that doesn't work on video for me.
It's the boy next door image, I think, that him and the coach.
Have you lived next door to someone like that?
Well, actually, no. Nobody used to have a hamster.
I don't think it really works on video. The thing about him is that, basically, he's a singer-songwriter. And apart from the fact that his songs are obviously you know, produced on synthesizers. He could just as well have been working 10 years ago. He would have been another David McWilliams, another Clifford T. Ward or something.
Who?
And, I think he's suffered from the fact that because everybody, to sell records these days, has to make a video, he feels he must visualize his songs somehow. And therefore, on this clip of film, you see him noodling about the place in this sort of jumpsuit and I think a slightly unsightly haircut.
But what is his appeal there?
His appeal?
Well, I mean, four hit singles off an album that goes to number one.
He writes very, very good songs. Yeah. Very good songs indeed.
Are they a bit
melodies.
Trite? There's,
No, I don't think so.
They're good pop songs. Yeah. It's no more trite than She Loves You. Yeah,
they're very intimate songs. Yeah.
Robin?
Well, I don't think it's the lyrical content that makes him. It makes his records attractive. He makes good pop music, you know, simple as that, plays on the radio. The thing I liked about the video, probably, was the fact that I thought it was brave to go from, to allow the comparison between live music and the recorded version. I thought that was very brave because it didn't work too well very often. The exception would be Hope You Find It and the acoustic piano version, that was great. But as a video, I ended up getting a bit bored, even though I think he does do good pop music.
What about a soloist like this, just with synthesizers, as opposed to someone playing with a large band like you have?
Well, what can I say? It's not my bag, man. It's good pop music. I don't think it matters whether it's a solo artist or not, you know. He's good at what he does.
And as a video? I mean, it's an hour for, what, nearly £15?
Well, for a Howard Jones fan, it'd be great, you know. If you're a little girl who thinks he's a hunk, then you'd get off on it, I suppose. But I thought it was a bit boring.
And Howard Jones is now working on songs for his next album. Jerry Dammers, once leader of that wonderful band The Specials, seems to have been doing just that for most of the 80s. For literally years now, there have been reports that the Special AKA album was almost finished and just about to be released. Now it is actually ready, though half of the 10 tracks on the appropriately titled In the Studio have actually appeared already on singles. Still, it's an interesting album, a sophisticated blend of reggae, funk, Latin, African and jazz styles, with Rhoda Dacker and Stan Campbell handling the vocals, and brass added on many tracks. There's some humour on the album, as in What I Like Most About You Is Your Girlfriend, on which Dammers sings, but most of the songs are more serious, like the hit single Nelson Mandela, a track produced by Elvis Costello. Here's another good single that wasn't a hit, Racist Friend. It's been a long, long time coming, all that.
I knew you were going to come to me first. Here we go. Yes, I'm happy to say it was. I was disappointed. First time I heard it, I thought, oh dear.
And then, why so?
Well, just because I didn't like it very much. It's a grower. It's a grower, that album. I don't think the production's brilliant, but it sounds better on a car cassette than it does on a hi-fi.
What, the Dammers production or the Costello production? Because he did...
Costello's... Well,
Nelson Mandela, didn't he?
It's very sort of patchy. It's up and down, the whole album is, but there's some great tracks. And the one you said, What I Like Most About You Is Your Girlfriend, is hilarious. That's a work of art. That one's okay, Racist Friend. That doesn't sound like the album mix. It may be that it's just coming across the TV, but the album mix sounds better than that. As an album, it's fine. I admire... Dammers and Rimshot, what a ridiculous name. Sorry, John. But I admire what they're doing, you know, what they're trying to do. Just basically doing what they want. rather than trying to fit into a commercial bag.
Another user.
Word. I like the album. It grew on me.
Are they similar to UB40, do you think? I mean, you both come from the Midlands, you're both a multiracial, politically aware band.
They're probably similar in outlook. And the way they work is very sort of communal, you know, which is how we are. Very long-winded, that's why it takes them 2 years to get an album out. Musically,
there's a bit of reggae there, but not as much as you do, obviously.
Yeah, well, I mean, we sort of came up around the same time, them before us, but we were playing reggae and always had done, and they sort of came along on the ska revival thing, you know, well, they started it. So, I mean, we were sort of lumped in with Two Tone because we were dragged along on their shirt tails, more or less. But we never were a Two Tone band.
You presumably wouldn't spend 2 years in the studio making an album, would you?
We've got our own studio. We might do. It's very difficult.
Is that a fault, do you think? They've been there too long?
It may be that they've done too many mixes of this album. It sounds like it. I think that may be why it sounds so patchy. The fact that, you know, it sounds like they've gone over and over tracks, you know, whereas they shouldn't have done. They should have just let them go out with, you know, like 10 mixes ago or whatever.
Right. John, you used to live in Birmingham, just down the road from all of this.
Yes.
Yeah, he was on Two Tone as well.
We were dragged along on their shirt tails. I've had this album lying around for a week. I suppose I agree in that I sort of do admire Jerry Damas to an extent. By the same token, I think the band that was responsible for bringing the ska revival and probably the skinhead revival back into England had got a lot to answer for, and I don't think that was a particularly one of Britain's finest moments of the last 5 years, but I don't like the Specials particularly. I never really have.
I just
don't like that sort of music. I remember seeing them at the Mayfair, supporting the Clash, the Coventry Automatics, and Steel Pulse, I think it was, they played with. And that was just as they were starting to form, because they were originally like a sort of punk. It was punky, wasn't it? Yeah. And then they started to develop the thing and sort of...
What were they called? Coventry Specials.
Coventry, yeah. Automatics and the Coventry Specials. I think what the Funboy 3 had done, I think that listening to the album now, it sounds really dated. And even though when the Specials were the Specials and they were playing new ska,
it didn't sound dated somehow.
It sounded quite new. Now it sounds really dated.
Maybe if they brought it out straight away, it would have been okay, but yeah. 2 years in the studio, only 3 years in the studio, it's an awful long time, isn't it?
I don't know. It doesn't... I mean, I would never have thought it had taken two years to make. I can't believe it. Maybe I've just... I think the Funboy 3 took a good move away from what the Specials have been doing, and they tried to develop something new, what they were doing. It doesn't do anything, and I don't think it's going to...
I'm sure that must be just like the Human League. If you spent 2.5 years making an album, which has got to follow up an incredibly successful album before, it's not surprising that both those albums don't appear to have much humour on them. Because you've got to wake up every day and you've got to think, I've got to make this album, and the longer you leave it... Jerry Damas must have been through hell making this album.
Do you think it's going to sell? I mean, Nelson Mandela's obviously a brilliant song, I think, and it sold very well, but that was a Costello production.
I think it's much more live than the rest of it. Exciting album.
I think there's better tracks than Mandela on the album, for sure.
There are.
And I started off, as I was saying, I didn't think it was a good album. I was really disappointed on first hearing, but it only took the second play, and I've played it a lot since then. I think it's a very commercial album. I think there's several singles on there.
But it's so exciting, you know. Very few albums are a real adventure, you know. You put them on and you just don't know what the next track's going to be like, what it's going to be about, what sounds will be in it, how it's arranged.
And I thought it was really dated. I really don't think it's dated, because it's so varied. You know, yeah. I mean, there are some. It sounds like a fun experiment to me. And
what I miss about the early Specials is that they could make very salient, very important topical political points very forcefully, but do it as if it was a kind of byproduct of this wonderfully exhilarating dance music. You know, right. I think this is a little serious.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. That's exactly.
Yeah, there's a lot of politics here, certainly on the second side, particularly.
But I think it's important. Somebody should be doing that. You know.
I agree. And now they've actually got their album out, the Specials are resting. They've not planned any concerts to promote it. Now, the precarious world of pop journalism. During the 80s, at least 30 new pop publications have hit the bookstalls in Britain, and only half of them have actually survived this far. As for the publications that are still going, the weekly papers have, for the most part, been losing their readership just slightly. The more glossy, fortnightly or monthly publications have generally been doing better. Into this turbulent market now comes a new contender. Debut magazine costs £2.99 and consists of a 62-page glossy coffee table magazine and a compilation album thrown in. the journalists are all apparently new to the music business, and so say they hope to avoid what they call the padding and flannel of regular music publications. The artists you can read about and listen to this month include Swan's Way, Scott Walker, The Waterboys, and Ultravox. Mark, I know this is, what, £2.50 more than Smash Hits. Is it going to make any dent in your market at all?
I don't think it will, actually, and I know these two will agree with me because I've just given them a large sum of money to
Yes,
you'll be going to make a dent in any market.
You'll be forced to be on the cover of Smash Hits next week.
I tell you what I think my major concern about this is the idea of the compilation album itself, because basically there are only two types of compilation albums that actually sell. One is the kind
this
of
is the free album that comes with the expensive magazine.
Basically, people either like K-Tel type albums, you know, which have all the hits on them and you can stick them on the party tape and you don't have to buy the singles, or else they like these kind of generic types with all heavy metal or all hip-hop or all high energy or something like that, where all the tracks actually sound the same. But I don't know if they'd really go for this, because, I mean, let's have a look at it.
There's bits of everything, aren't there, from Carmel to Swan's Way to Ultravox.
It is an odd collection, actually, which I think is going to be... could be a bit of a downfall for it. It hasn't gone in any definite direction one way or the other. You know, as you say, it's Swan's Way or Ultravox or Scott Walker.
That's what I like about it.
Well, you've got a couple of good tracks. I mean, you might want the Ultravox track. You might want the Carmel track or something like that. You might be interested in Orange Juice. But after that, you're left with Illustrated Man.
MC202 microcomposer.
Well,
but what about the idea, though, of mixing journalism with music? I mean, we've tried with Flexipop, who gave out flexi discs of the magazine. It's tried, I suppose, with SFX, which was a cassette magazine. Both of those have folded, haven't they, now?
I'm suspicious about the nature of this thing for the simple reason that if you want to get tracks off a record company, this is just a technical fact, the only way to really you can do it is to go along there and say, all right, say you go to Chrislist and say, give me an Ultravox track. They'll probably say, well, look, you've got to take a Steve Levine track as well. And we've also got to have two-page features on both of them. So in the end, the whole thing just turns out to be advertising for the record companies. And you are totally in the hands of the record companies. It's very difficult to get good tracks.
Well, so they do have to be very safe, you mean, in order to give you your tracks?
I think so, yeah. But it's the fact that you can't really control it. I mean, what I liked about SFX, which is defunct 2 or 3 years ago, was it really used to go out and interview unknown bands without record company backing, and give them exposure. These people don't, because the only bands they can really deal with are people that already have a record contract, already have finished product, and they go to the record companies, and the record companies are only too delighted to give them these tracks to give them a bit of extra exposure. So as an A&R exercise, I don't think it's that successful.
Robin, would you give them a track at an interview?
Would I give it? Certainly. I think the thing is, what I like about that magazine is precisely what nobody else appears to like, is the fact that it's so varied. I like the idea of a compilation album that you don't know what's going to be on it. I like that idea that you're going to be exposed to stuff that you would maybe normally not hear on the radio, or certainly wouldn't go out and buy their album. Well, maybe only once.
Yeah. For $2.99.
But that's right, that's the big drawback. The big drawback, it's a beautifully produced, very glossy, very nice, crap interviews, but it's beautifully produced, it looks great, and the idea's wonderful, but it's £3 and £3
it does look
is a joke. You should get the free synthesizer for £3, you know what I mean?
John, I do like the idea that it's the first magazine that really disposes of the journalist in a way, and that you actually get to make up your own mind about the records that are being talked about.
There's lots of journalism in there.
Well, I wouldn't say that. That's the thing is the worst thing about it. Is that
would be journalism,
if I might,
so please do.
Draw to your attention. Actually, we did all agree, this is the first thing we've all agreed on, actually, was that it did read a little bit like a sixth form.
It reads a bit like a Billy
Bob. And we'll turn to page.
A bad sixth form magazine.
Actually, when it put your hands around in the same category as the Bassist Rollers and David Cassidy, I didn't get past page six, actually. But no, when the first page is taken up with the editor's problems over getting the launch party at Legends together, and what were the problems getting the first edition out on the street?
And going on holiday to Cornwall, and what's wrong with Cornwall?
it's a little lacking in direction, I think.
But a good idea if it was properly written. I mean, would you give them an interview?
I think it's a great idea. Yeah.
And it looks really sophisticated as well.
I don't think I'll ever buy Smash Hits again.
It's a great time to tell.
Well, it just doesn't compare to Smash Hits. You know, I mean, Smash Hits is a wonderful weekly that couldn't come out every week. I mean, it doesn't really compete. They're not in the same market. But it's too expensive. Can I have the money now? just too expensive. £3 is a joke.
It is appallingly expensive. At £1.99, say, or...
Yeah, and if they've got a mutual thing where they're getting these tracks for free and the bands are getting publicity out of it, then, it should be a lot cheaper than that. I don't believe the cost can be that much, even though I'm assured that they are.
Mm. You see, that's the thing about there being so many diverse acts, which, okay, is good in a way. But if a kid, say, your average Ultravox fan or whatever, they're going to be paying £2.99 for, say, the Ultravox track, which they probably got on the album anyway, and maybe they want to hear Swan's Way. But, like,
it's
getting £2.99 out of somebody...
Money, you could buy a couple of singles and just tape a couple of other things off somebody...
They're going to stop you, sorry. And the second edition of Debut was given a nationwide launch yesterday, and it's supposed to be available both in bookshops and record stores. It's possible to divide rock enthusiasts into two categories. There are those for whom Bruce Springsteen is a good, solid, white American rock and roller, much obsessed by cars, and those for whom Bruce Springsteen is God. The second category are getting very excited this week because there's a new Bruce Springsteen album. Unlike his last offering, Nebraska, this is a full-blown rock and roll set, the first he's made with the E Street Band since The River back in October 1980. It includes his hit Dancing in the Dark and typically bleak, romantic, but stirring songs like Darlington County. Which of you do? John.
Bruce, well, he's a legend. Legend.
In his own lunchtime.
God, reborn with a Telecaster in his hands. I'm never quite understood what has made... I was saying to somebody earlier, I was reading through a magazine and it said, on 8 days a week, tonight, we have John Taylor, Robin Campbell and Mark...
That's Mark over there.
And reviewing the new... talking about a new LP on the streets debut... the new album from the Specials and the new Bruce Springsteen Meisterwerk. You know, why do people write...
I wouldn't call it a Meisterwerk, I'd call it a rock and roll album.
But people do say Meisterwerk. When they think of Bruce Springsteen, they think of things like legend or semi-legendary or Meisterwerk. And I don't know why.
What do you think of him, though?
I think he's very overrated. He's got immense charm as a character. I love him as a character, as a musician, as a singer. I think he's very overrated.
Have you ever seen him live?
No, which I'm told is, makes all the difference. I mean, Andy says he's... He's pretty good, and he likes rock and roll.
What about him as an image of a man, though? That's the important thing.
He's a hunk, isn't he?
He's a hunk. And there is a hunk. That's no hamster.
There's the hunk for you.
He looks like he hasn't taken the coat hanger out of his jacket.
I mean, the album is 10 tracks of... I mean, all the Bruce fans are going to like it, because I think after Nebraska, it's a return to what one expects from Bruce Springsteen.
Yes, but less grand than The River and Born to Run, which were sort of mega productions. It's much more straightforward rock and roll album.
I think that's what it is. It's a straightforward rock and roll album.
It's great in the car.
I don't know. Not for mine, it isn't. Well, I bet it isn't yours either.
Mark, would you play it in your car?
I bet he
would. I know.
What can I say? I did.
I think it's all right. What, it's almost as though he's becoming a kind of modern equivalent of classical music. Do you know what I mean? This kind of, this is what rock is all about. And you feel that in future generations, people will be turning to their parents and say, what is rock music? And they say, well, it's called Bruce Springsteen, yes. And it sounds like this.
Is that because he over-promoted in the old days? I mean, when he started on?
No, I think he's got it.
Not really. I think he's very good, and I have seen him in concert, and he was terrific, actually. But it's just funny that 10 years ago, he was producing exactly the same songs. In essence, they were all about being in an open-top car and having $200 a night and wanting to rock all night and all sort of stuff. And he still will be in 10 years' time. The only thing that's different is the E Street band used to look like a bunch of hippies. Now they're balding a bit.
Well,
they look like members of the Labour Party.
He's driving Rolls Royces with him instead of beating up Chevys.
Robin.
What can I say? Not my bag, man. It's... I really don't know how to criticise this album, you know. It's not my sort of music. I have nothing to sort of compare it to. He's obviously good. The E Street Band are brilliant, and Clarence Clemons, he's
what about him as a songwriter, then?
Good.
His lyrics, I mean, he's writing a lot about unemployment.
He's working edgewise, will he? I was just going to say.
Sorry.
I was far more impressed with his lyrics than I was with the music. I think he's a good songwriter. That's simple. Not a brilliant songwriter, just a good songwriter.
What about his treatment of themes like unemployment?
What about him?
Well, it's the sort of thing that you haven't actually directly written about, but you're... UB40 is clearly unemployment-y.
Well, yeah, we're called UB40, yeah.
Would you find him a good songwriter?
Yeah, I think he's a good songwriter, but he writes in a completely different way. He writes in American style, you know. I couldn't write a song like he writes about, you know, working on the chain gang
writing
and all that kind of stuff.
Writing on the 50 bus never has quite the same ring.
Yeah, right, I'm riding on the 50 bus, doesn't, you know, it wouldn't make a good rock and roll. I don't know, maybe it would. But... it's just very difficult for me to say a lot about Bruce Springsteen. He's obviously good, and I've heard that live he's stunning.
That is whatever.
His sax player is brilliant. And the band are obviously good, and it is good driving music. I was far more impressed with it coming down today.
You've just been playing it coming down from Birmingham, have you?
Yeah, right, I listened to it again. That isn't the only time I've listened to it, I must say. But, I'll put it on, and you start to get into it then. Strucker's music.
And Bruce Springsteen and the E Street Band start an American tour later this month. He'll be here in the spring next year. In the meantime, he's just about to make his first ever video. And that's it from 8 Days This Week, with many thanks to John Taylor, Robin Campbell and Mark Ellen. Join us again next week when the guests will be Gary Kemp of Spandau Ballet.